So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Jack Reynolds, director of the Yale University Art Gallery, and on behalf of all my colleagues, I want to welcome you here for this wonderful concluding program for Jazz Lives, this great project that's been organized with Marlene Theodore and three Yale students that have brought us this great exhibition of Milt Hinton's photographs and those of Lee Friedlander's that have been up now for a number of months with wonderful musical programming and talks by many people. A number of you just saw the wonderful film on Milt Hinton's life that Holly and David made. And Marlene, I want to thank you for organizing these wonderful programs. And I want to say a little bit about sort of the history of how this came to be. It's actually 20 years ago when I was running the Addison Gallery of American Art. I've long had an interest in music and people who were devoted to teaching young people, which is one of the reasons I came down here to work, is I knew about the photographs of Milt Hinton, and I'd met David and Holly and inquired whether we could show some of their photographs and maybe bring Milt up to Andover, where we could perhaps interest him in conducting some master classes with a wonderful prep school and public high school musicians there. And that turned out to be an absolutely wonderful experience. We added not only some great teaching to the musical traditions at Andover, but some wonderful photographs to the Addison Gallery's collection. And then I came down here to Yale, and I heard about a guy named Willie Ruff. Judy Pfaff, an artist I know who got her MFA here, is a fabulous sculptor and recent MacArthur Fellow winner, said, Jack, you got to meet this guy, Willie Ruff. She said, one of the great things about going to Yale is you don't just go to an art school. You can take classes all over the university. And he taught a course, a kind of cross-disciplinary course on rhythm, was one of the most exciting things I did all during my time at Yale. And I'll tell you, Willie can teach rhythm method much better than the Catholic Church. needless to say, I wanted to meet this guy, and I found out he'd already had a long involvement with the art gallery in our programs, and we instantly became great friends, and I've had the pleasure of teaching sessions in his rhythm seminar for years now. And I found out that he was a great friend of Milt Hinton. And one of the things I want you to all notice if you get a chance to go back up to the show before it closes this Sunday is there's a great Milt Hinton picture of Duke Ellington in Woolsey Hall in 1972 with Ellington at the piano and Joe Jones up behind him on the drums. It was taken by Milt, who was here for that very occasion. And Willie had started on the faculty in 1971, and in 72, he founded the Ellington Fellowships. And I know from looking out at this audience that many of you have attended many, many of those great concerts in our concert hall, but I don't know how many of you have also gone to this great Saturday sessions when all these jazz musicians come back and teach the young people the great traditions of music and pass it on. And that's something that so unites you and the judge. And I know there's great affection between you, so to have this program, to now have you present the final lecture and presentation of this series is a great honor, Willie, and we love what you've meant to this community and to the life of music at our university.
Well, thank you, Jack.
There you go.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. What an introduction. I know just about everybody here. It's a wonder we're all still alive. I'm seeing faces that I've seen happily at all kinds of jazz events in this town and on this campus. The story of jazz at Yale is a long, long story and not known by many people. I was so thrilled to be asked to talk about and to show you some photographs and some actual footage that tells some of that story, that tells a great deal of Milt Hinton's story. And I had the very good fortune of meeting Milton when I was a student at the School of Music and played my first record date with him in the rhythm section and Joe Jones and Billy Taylor at the piano. And we're talking about a long time ago when we were teenagers. And the trajectory has been fabulous. So when I came back to join the faculty in 1971, and the next year was able to organize the Duke Ellington Fellowship Program. The thing that impressed me about honoring all of those 40 fellows came all at one time. It was about half the number of people on that Harlem photograph, and we've got a great photographic collection of some of those seminal events there. But the thing that impressed me most about Milton's presence there was he was in his 60s in the northern part of it, and he brought his mama from Chicago. And she said it was one of the greatest honors she had ever seen her son get or receive. And she was so proud, and she said that she wished that some of the kids who had been sold papers for the Chicago Defender couldn't have been there, and especially her favorite of them, little Nathaniel, Nat King Cole, and Ray Nance, who you'll see in some of the footage that we've done today. Everybody who knows me cannot miss knowing that I'm from Alabama. And I cannot stay out of there. Something about it that pulls me back all the time. And I want to show you a map of the state where some very, very important things happened to me as a small kid. And let me see if I can get this.
We will.
Okay. There it is. Edison's talking machine in the American jazz century. First thing I want to remind us of is that this is the 100th anniversary of the St. Louis Blues. 100 years ago, W.C. Handy from Florence, Alabama, composed that song, and it is the granddaddy of the blues. It has been recorded more than any other, to my knowledge. I don't have an exact count because people are recording it still. But you couldn't grow up in Florence, Alabama, and not encounter this great place . There it is. Sheffield is my hometown. That's where I was born. W.C. Handy was born in Florence, and you'll see Scottsboro over to the right and Tuskegee down lower. Right away, I could remind you of an interesting connection between this university and Tuskegee. One of Yale's presidents, past presidents, was born and raised in Tuskegee. His name is Howard Lamar, professor of history here. His father was a contractor, the construction contractor, who built the airfield at Tuskegee. Now, Tuskegee loomed large in my boyhood. One of the things that made it special was that we knew that there was some great music down there, and it was being played by the airmen in the Air Corps. And something happened that I'll show you a bit later here, but I want to show you this very musical little school that I attended. And the little guy in the middle there with the dark on the first row with the short pants, and all of us had short pants, but mine are dark, and I have a little dark sweater. I'm dead center. You can't miss me. I was 6 years old in the second grade, and because of Mr. Handy, his notoriety was just towering. There was nobody in our world more important. He had several careers before he came to our school one morning, and there he is. We knew about him from newspapers. We knew that he had once taught at Alabama A&M, and one of his students was the dentist in our little town, married to our fourth grade teacher, she was the prettiest woman I had ever seen in my life, looked good enough to sop with a biscuit. And I swore when I grew up I wanted a wife just like Miss Coker. We arrived at school that one morning and the principal met us at the door and said, "Don't go to your classrooms, we have a visitor." And I couldn't believe it when this gentleman stepped out on the stage, clean as the Board of Health, and twice as sharp. And he started talking to us about the importance of our musical story and of our cultural heritage. And years later, I heard from a radio broadcast one of the things that he said to us there in that school. And I want you to hear it. Really a sad story.
I couldn't tell the story of the St. Louis Blues and leave out one about a morning when my old teacher down in Florence, Alabama, called our class together, and instead of hearing our lessons, began to question us as to what we intended to do and be in life. Some wanted to be doctors, lawyers, teachers, merchants, and so forth, and when it came to me, I said, "I want to be a musician." He read me a lecture, said music would bring me to the gutter. Musicians were idlers, dissipated characters. He wrote my father a note which, when he read, he said, "Sonny, I'd rather follow you to your grave than to see you be a musician."
Now that was cold. That was cold. But he came out on the stage with his trumpet, and he told us how he had found that his father and his teacher, his father was his minister, and he was born in 1873. Their feelings about music and musicians was obviously not good, but he said he spent the rest of his days trying to find a place in music. And he says both his father and his teacher were right. Music did take him to the gutter. He said he found himself broke, hungry, without work, no place to sleep in St. Louis. And he says, "You children will know what it feels like to have the story to tell that I had in my memory when I started to write St. Louis Blues. If you've ever slept on cobblestones, you will know why I chose to open St. Louis Blues. I hate to see the evening sun go down. Have to sleep on those cobblestones again, you know." But he said, "I went about trying to prove my father and my teacher wrong in a number of jobs." He got a job in a minstrel show, and he advanced to become the conductor of the minstrel show. And he says, "I had 43 of the finest musicians in the country in my band." And he says, "And before each show, whether we were playing in tents or theaters, we would stand with our orchestra outside and play 1 hour of concert classical music. So we knew, and I knew, that there was worth there, along with much else that was there." But he said, "I saw it all as things of value." And then he got this job teaching up at Huntsville at A&M, and then went back with the minstrel show, went to Memphis, formed bands, became a contractor, and by the time he had come back to our school, he was a very rich man because he published all of his own music. That's something. St. Louis Blues earned him enough money to burn up a wet mule. And not only did he have St. Louis Blues, he had Memphis Blues, Beale Street Blues, Aunt Hegge's Blues, and a whole lot of other people. Fletcher Henderson began his musical career working in the office demonstrating music in Handy's office in Harlem. He was the most well-off musician and publisher in the Harlem Renaissance. He owned a record company, Black Swan Records. And Ethel Waters told me, I had to go to his office and ask permission to record the St. Louis Blues. And she said, and he had Fletcher Henderson there who really didn't like jazz. He had graduated from Atlanta University, had come to New York to study chemistry to get a master's degree at Columbia in chemistry. And Handy gave him a job because he could play the piano. And Ethel Waters says, I asked him to play the piano for me, and he asked me for the music. And I said, what is this? He's going to play the blues and he needs music? Huh? So they made a record, and it became sensational. It put Black Swan Records on the map, so Ethel Waters told me. And she said, Fletcher just couldn't get it in his mind and his soul what I needed. Says she couldn't give me any inspiration. She said, and then one day after the record came out, they sent us to Chicago to promote it. And said, we couldn't stay in the hotels downtown. She said, so we kept a roster of the places with rooming houses that had player pianos, because the way you kids go around with cassettes now, we went around with our piano rolls. And we didn't stay any place that didn't have a good player piano in it, so we could take our rolls. So she said, so this one day I had a record, a cylinder, record, you know, piano player, of James P. Johnson, Worried and Lonesome Blues. And she said, I put it on in the landlady's house, and I called Fletcher. He had a room upstairs. Called him down and said, now, Fletcher, look at this. Look at the keys. That'll tell you where to put your fingers. And she says, and the landlady and I went shopping. And we came back, and Fletcher still had the roll in the piano, I thought. She said, but when I got there, opened the door, the roll wasn't in the piano. And she says, that boy's life changed just like that. He then became the Fletcher Henderson you know. Now, Handy also employed U.B. Blake in his publishing office. As a matter of fact, U.B. Blake married Handy's secretary. They stayed married for the rest of his life. He lived to be 101, almost. And he was the one who said, if I'd known I was going to live so long, I would have taken better care of myself. Chain smoker. He didn't live a very clean life. So Handy was somebody to me. We don't have many heroes that stood as tall as Handy stood in our forest. Handy had made such an impression on the children of that place. And when he had finished his talk, all of us who were identified as musically inclined were permitted to shake the hand that wrote St. Louis Blues. I was never the same boy again. I wouldn't wash that hand. My mama said, boy, washing that hand is not gonna kill you. I said, yeah, mama, but why take chances? Well, after Handy left, we had another phenomenal gentleman in our town.
that people nickeled and dimed up enough money to send him to Tuskegee. And he then attracted the attention of one of Tuskegee's most important board members,
Julius Rosenwald. Everybody knows who Julius Rosenwald, don't you? President of Sears Roebuck and Company, right? Built 5,373 schools for Negro children throughout the South and most of the southern states. Mr. Swopes came to be himself a member of the board of directors of the Tuskegee Institute. Now that's going. Taylor, custom tailor, and cleaners and dyers. When was the last time you ever heard of a dyer? Mr. Swopes could do it. He did it all with that. And war broke out, and children all over America started selling war bonds and war stamps, you know, raising money for the war effort that way. And because Mr. Swopes had pull at Tuskegee, he persuaded the administration there to energize the war bond rally up in our town by having the band from Tuskegee take the bus, their own bus, up to Sheffield to parade down our main street, Montgomery Avenue, and to send a squadron of pilots to fly low so we could get a look at their handsome brown faces. And the most prominent piece they played as they marched down the street was the march on the St. Louis Blues. I want you to imagine that band singing on that sunny day. Go ahead. Sun sparkling off of those instruments. Those guys, just nearly 100 of them, it looked like. And then, by and by, we heard the roar of airplanes. Stop you right here because I just met this man last year. We were both at the railroad station in Hartford. He was taking a train back to New York where he lives. I was taking a train back to New Haven. And I saw that he was holding a briefcase like one I own. Black canvas and had the lettering Tuskegee Airmen Incorporated. I went over to him and I introduced myself. He says, I know who you are. And I said, I think I know who you are, but tell me more. And we got to going, sat down on the train and just yacked and raised cane all the way to New Haven when I had to get off. And I Googled him. That's a long way from Sheffield way back then in Google. I'm gonna kill Google. They know too much. They got your business. But what I found out, you see two swastikas on that fighter plane, that's P-51 Mustang. I knew that three of the Tuskegee Airmen had shot down German Messerschmitt jets with that airplane, and he was one. I called him up, I said, man, why didn't you tell me? He said,
My mama wouldn't want me to. That'd be immodest. So we're going to get together again pretty soon, but I had to let you know about Roscoe. Now, the St. Louis Blues was actually recorded by Glenn Miller. There's Captain Glenn Miller at a time when he was stationed here in New Haven on the Yale campus, playing on the old campus, marching from the Yale Bowl where they were training downtown. That's a regular picture of a radio show broadcast from Woolsey Hall. And citizens of New Haven erected this stone. It's in the Grove Street Cemetery. Now, here's a photograph that I want you to have a close look at it. There are more than 800 souls in that photograph. It's just about the biggest photograph I've ever seen. I take it to places to get it reproduced down south, and people swoon. And I haven't been able to persuade the technicians to take money for photographing it. They have so much fun with it. Now, there are, as I said, more than 800 people in that photograph, and every one of them, from the colonel to the cook, are black. And it's an air base just outside Columbus, Ohio, Lockbourne Air Force Base. I want to show you something else in detail. Close up. Now, check out our medical staff. Look at those nurses. Look at those capes. There are our doctors there along with them, all of the pilots, all of the musicians, all of the women who were in the Air Corps at that time. And here's an interesting statistic. Out of the 800 people, if you took the trouble to count 8 tiers, each line across is more than 100 wide, 100 people. Yeah. Which means then that 1 out of 8 people there were musicians. That's a lot of music. What kind of music? Every kind. Concert classical music, boogie-woogie, ragtime, bebop. On Sunday afternoons, this entire organization would assemble itself into the Bass Theater, which was beautiful like this, except twice, a little more than twice the size, and hear a full concert. Now, there is one young man in our percussion section I want to focus a little bit on here. Young man named Elvin Jones. He was the master of the bass drum and the timpanis. And there he is with John Coltrane, driving the rhythmic orbit of him a few years later. And we go over, pan over to the other side of the picture, and there's Dwight Mitchell, 19 years old. I should have stopped it there. But there's 19-year-old Dwight Mitchell in that photograph, and the other person there is yours truly. And I was 16. I had already been in the Army 2 years. And Mitchell saw me one day fooling around with the bass fiddle, and he says, the bass player that I usually played with just got discharged. If you really want to learn how to play that thing, I can teach you. And he began teaching me on Tuesday, and on Saturday we played on the radio.
And he went on teaching me until he died last year. So he got it into his idea, into his mind, that we needed to go to China, which then would mean I would have to learn Mandarin so I could not shut up in Chinese. And I did. And this is what it looked like and sounded like. That's your song. Teenage students at this conservatory, I gave them three Super 8 cameras and said, shoot it. They shot it. Now, just in case you are laboring under the impression that the first important influence in jazz was Glenn Miller on this campus, you would be wrong. It's 1929. These Yale undergraduates, all but one was a student at the School of Music. He was not in Yale College. But these guys went to see Louis Armstrong at the old arena. Nobody here old enough to remember the old arena. Yeah? Well, Louis Armstrong came to town 1928 with Louis Russell's band. And somebody told him about these young guys, young white kids at Yale, back when it was a men's school. And very different, you know? And they came over and listened to these guys play and gave them their manager's telephone number and said, you should be heard. These guys went to New York, played for the manager, and got a record deal. Made records 1929, 1930, 1931. Went around the world. The recordings did. They couldn't keep them in record stores. How good were they? Every summer, they played the vaudeville circuit. Played the palace twice. The palace. I mean, that's like Carnegie Hall. You know, for that circuit, they couldn't keep their records in the record stores, and they became rock stars before rock and roll ever got invented. They were in demand on cruise ships. They played every weekend for dances all up and down the East Coast. Went to Europe on a cruise ship, earned them. It came out that they were making more money than some of their teachers, than most of their teachers. And one of the teachers, got very, one of the deans called him in, says, young men, there are finer things at Yale than that gutter music. And they staged a halftime show at the Yale Bowl for a football game and got a terrific response. In the newspapers the next morning, headline, blasphemy. Their manager, a man named John Curtis, graduated from this university having amassed $50,000 in his bank account. And I want you to check out this, how good these guys were on this. Putting
now,
on the ridge.
If you're blue, you don't know where to go to, why don't you go to Harlem Hill?
With the flappers and
bank account.
There were garages in town that made their living just renting space for these guys' sports cars. All of them, not just the band, but the students. Look at that.
Every Thursday evening with the sailboat of Melbourne. Bang, come with me, with hands that you see. Deep Spain, love to be, put on the ring.
Now, a few years, 20 years later, actually, there was still some resonances. This guy was really one of my great buddies. His name is Irwin Michnick, and he changed his name to Mitch Lee. And he was such an operator and such a musician. He was a drum major for the Yale band 1 year. And when he graduated, I took that job. But Mitch played at the Schubert for a revival of UB Blake's and Noble Sissle's Shuffle Along. There he was in the band, in the pit, and I'm sitting over there with my little French horn. And it wasn't many years before Mitch and Arthur Harris, another student, contrived in our chamber music classes, a jazz recording using a traditional woodwind quintet and a jazz rhythm section. Got us a record deal. We made a recording of it. Got to New York, and who's in the studio with us for our first recording deal? But Joe Jones, Milt Hinton, and Billy Taylor. Now, things had changed with the faculty, with the attitude about jazz, because one of our teachers, the great Keith Wilson, Keith Wilson was on that day. There's the great Keith Wilson. Moline went down and got that picture of Mitch for me. Now, I know you're going to say it. The old man's lost all of his marbles. Why is Commando Vanderbilt, what does he have to do with jazz and Yale? All of that. Well, let me tell you about the commander, the Commodore. The Commodore earned one of the great, great American industrial fortunes in shipping, and then he saw that railroad had promise. He bought all the rail lines, sold all his ships, built Grand Central Station twice, because the first one was flawed and kept killing people. So I had to take that one down. I'll show you a picture of it here. There it is. There's the old one. The exterior. Now look at the interior there. Is reminiscent of the interior of the new one. Huh? There's the new one. And that's the great hall that you look out into when you get to the other end of the line in New York. Huh? Vanderbilt Hall, about 50 feet down the street here, came from that wealth, built in 1893. Now, what the Commodore is responsible for is this guy. This was one of the most influential personalities in the whole story of jazz music. He and I met for the first time at a nightclub I used to own about a mile from here, a little less as the crow flies. Playback over on Winchester Avenue. And I actually bought the place and started running it because Mitchell and I tried to be a trio for a little while, and we had the great drummer Charlie Smith, and we, you know, and John Hammond had found this girl singer in Hartford, and he recorded her, and she wanted a French horn on her recording, so he hired me, and we were recording in New York at Columbia Records Studio, and he says, "Willie, somebody told me you went to the Yale School of Music." I said, "Yeah, that's right." He said, "Well, where are you from?" I said, "I'm from a little obscure town in northwest Alabama that you never heard of." He said, "Well, do you want to try me?" And I said, "I'm from Sheffield." He says, "I know it well." Why would a cat who's brought up in a house that looks like Downton Abbey know somebody from Sheffield, Alabama? Really, in the sticks. And he says, "Well, in 1932, when I was 22 years old, he said, I covered the Scottsboro trial for the Nation. He says, I bought a brand new Packard Roadster and drove down there. And he says, that was the most depressing experience. Every day at the end of that trial, he says, I felt like, I don't know how, what expression he used, but it was nice. And he said, I asked people, where do I have to go? Do I have to go all the way to Birmingham to hear some real authentic black music? And he said, no, you got to go to Sheffield. That's where all the riffraff lives. And he said, and they were right. Because there was a chitlin strut just about every night. And the music was authentic. You know that place now is Muscle Shoals. But this is what John was talking about long before. Muscle Shoals didn't exist as a town then. It was nothing but woods. And Muscle Shoals, that expression referred to a steep impediment or drop-off in the river that messed up the shipping. So they built this huge dam, the Army Corps of Engineers. We boast there a lock, a navigational lock, that drops 100 feet in one story. It was there in advance of World War I, and they manufactured nitrate for ammunition there. Henry Ford tried to buy it because he wanted to move Detroit to there. Hence, we have the only cotton fields in the South with curbs and hydrants. They put all of that in there, right? And that's why all the riffraff came there from everywhere. Muscle Shoals wasn't a township, a post office, or anything. It was the woods. We used to hunt rabbits in what's now Muscle Shoals. Well, John Hammond played a large part and had a big influence on my musical life. And as I said, I met him at this nightclub that I owned. He came up often, drove up from New York, easy time of it. And one day, he had been there two or three times. He called me on the phone. He says, "Willie, I need a favor." And I said, "Well, what can I do to help you, John?" He says, "I have this young girl. I'm recording her here in New York, and she's making her first album, and it's jazz." And says, "She's good." And she said, "But she's going crazy because she's been in the record studios every day for a couple of weeks, and she would like to sing for a live audience." And he says, "It won't mean anything to you, so if you will allow her to come up, and she plays the piano, and she'll play for herself, play with you and Charlie." He said, "You don't have to pay her. Columbia Records will take care of that." And he says, "I'll put her on the train." And back then, you see, there were several nonstop express trains from New Haven to 125th Street and then Grand Central. But that first stop, 55 minutes. They've stretched it out. We're not as close as we used to be to New York. I was accustomed to seeing the same people in all of the gin mills that I played all up and down and across this town, see them here one night, Birdland the next night. Hmm? So he said, I'll put her on a train, and you pick her up at the station. And I said, well, tell me what she looks like, and does she have a name? And he says, yeah, it's Aretha. And she came, and we had a grand time. So about 3 or 4 years ago, Jock will remember, because you were there with somebody else. It might have been Lee Friedlander. But Yale University gave Aretha an honorary doctorate. Huh? And she told Rick Levin, she says, you know, I began my career here. I said, where? She says, well, have you ever heard of this very interesting man named Willie Ruff? I didn't attend commencement on the old campus because we have one separate one in the School of Music. But my dean's phone rings, and he says to the voice on, yeah, he's here. And I was told to repair to Sterling to have lunch with the honorands, and especially Aretha, sit at her table. So there are a lot of nice connections in my life with John Hammond. Aretha is one of them. Leonard Cohen is the other. John asked me to get him out of trouble because all of the bass players that he hired to play with Leonard Cohen on his first Columbia Records quit because Leonard couldn't read music or let them know precisely what they, and John says, you can figure him out. If you just put aside, not take any other work until we get this done. It might take a week or two. It took 2 weeks. So John, I watched his career, and I only learned a few months ago that American Masters, PBS, had made a documentary on John. And I think that his story is important, so important that I want you to see a part of it. I'm not going to play the whole thing, but the real gist of it is here. So this is my friend John Hammond.
This is John Hammond, Vice President of Columbia Records, talking to Willie Ruff and Robert Dick. I was born on December 15th, 1910, so that sort of dates me. And I got interested in listening to music on records when I was about 3 years old. It would start with Sir Harry Lauder and Caruso and, various other cats. And then I didn't get interested in jazz till about 1920. One of the first tunes I ever remember on our piano was I'm Just Wild About Harry, which came from the original Shuffle Along of 1921, I guess, and which one of my sisters played. And the first blues record that I got firsthand was the James P. Johnson, Worried and Lonesome Blues. And that's the record that changed my life, because until that time, I had been sort of a scraping away on violin, not very well, and listening to classical music and listening to every violinist that I could. And I finally heard real, authentic blues on piano. And I didn't know there were such things as race records. And I found out in 1924 that there were. And as soon as I found out there were race records, then that brought me to Bessie Smith, that brought me to Louis Armstrong, that brought me to Mamie Smith, that brought me principally to the whole instrumental catalog of black jazz, which has remained, I guess, almost my primary interest in music. Principally, I got interested in black jazz. I got from James B. Johnson. I got to hear his pupil, Fats Waller, who accompanied a lot of great blues singers on OK and other labels, and so. At a time when white kids just were not interested in black music at all, I became, completely absorbed in it. Then when Louis Armstrong picked up Earl Hines, that was another big thing in my life, because Earl Hines probably was the first sophisticated ensemble jazz piano player on records. And I guess West End Blues was the record that hit me between the eyes, and I guess that was almost that and Hotter Than That. But I think really West End Blues was the first that really hit me. And by that time, I was convinced that there was no place for me except in the record business. I should have been a lawyer and a banker like my father. And I said no, because there is something about records that nothing else can. I'm a complete romantic about it. I don't know whether I ought to put this on tape, but my kicks from records, you can leave it going, Willie, my kicks from records were a sublimation of everything. I got my sexual stimulus, I got my emotional stimulus, everything, from black jazz on records. I was so inhibited, I didn't chase after chicks, I didn't smoke, I didn't drink, I didn't do anything. But this thing, I got this thrill from records before I was allowed to go out to hear the live stuff in its native haunts. And it had such an effect on me. It was the first big effect that ever was in my life, and this is why I stuck with it.
My man don't love me, he treats me oh so mean.
Few people outside the music industry know his name, but John Hammond, though not himself a professional musician, exerted greater influence on America's cultural life, and by extension, the world's, than most performers. Hammond had a genius for discovering and nurturing talent. His enthusiasm for black artists proved contagious. By introducing them into the mainstream, he permanently changed the face of contemporary music. It's safe to assume that few people can appreciate the forces that have driven American music from sharecropper blues to rock and roll. But John Hammond was able to hear the underlying connection.
We had a sort of a large house on 91st Street. We had about 15 servants. They had their own Columbia Graffinola down in the servants' quarters, and so I used to spend a lot of my time down there, too. My mother was a Vanderbilt, liked only classical music, and I would be dragged to Carnegie Hall, where we had a box at the New York Philharmonic. And I used to think, why is this music not as exciting to me as what I'm buying on records? I started as a record collector when I was about 10 years old, 1921. And I found a record by a piano player called James P. Johnson. And James P. Johnson wrote the original Charleston, and he was one of the great piano players of all times. And he had a record called Worried and Lonesome Blues, which he made an old blue label Columbia record in 1922. And this is the record that changed my life. And then I had to find out where you could hear a guy like this. The house was so big, the family never knew whether I was in or not. And I used to sneak out of school and either walk or take a trolley to the middle of Harlem and just roam around and look at the theaters and everything. I I was too young to go to a nightclub or anything, and I didn't smoke, and I didn't drink, and I was a complete Boy Scout. But I got to meet musicians. They used to look at me and think I was crazy. White kids weren't supposed to like music like that. In 1927, the Alhambra Theater, which had always been a white vaudeville theater, had become a black theater, and it said on the marquee of that theater, "This week in person, the Empress of the Blues, Bessie Smith." Bessie Smith at the height of her career. She just wiped the audience out. She had powerful pipes. It was the biggest thrill of my life.
Hammond's love of Bessie Smith never wavered. He considered the Empress of the Blues, as Bessie was widely known, to be the most accomplished vocalist ever to come out of the blues tradition. As a Vanderbilt, Hammond was untouched by the Great Depression, but like so many of his generation, he was radicalized by it.
Nobody knows you when you're down and out.
You have to realize what John was like, because in so many ways he was like my mother. They were both idealists. They both wanted to make the world a better place to live in. They both wanted to run other people's lives. They were really reformers in the sense of true reformers.
By this time, I was a dedicated radical. And I started writing for The Nation. My father said that if I ever worked for that kind of a paper, I would end up a communist. But as soon as I got a few front page bylines, suddenly the family thought it was wonderful. And in 1932, the Scottsboro case broke.
Nine black youths were framed on charges of raping two white women in a freight car passing through Alabama. It was one of the most sensational trials of the decade, and Hammond's coverage in The Nation was widely noted. Hammond's involvement in the case, which included producing a benefit concert, led to his joining the board of the NAACP. Hammond was not destined to be an investigative reporter. Returning to music, he became one of the most prolific jazz critics of the 1930s. His outspoken opinions sparked debates on both sides of the Atlantic. Ever the activist, he began producing records by several of his favorite artists, including the architect of big band music, Fletcher Henderson. He was determined to record his now-forgotten idol, Bessie Smith. And characteristically, he financed the records out of pocket.
So as you can see, I was fairly a determined guy. I was going to be in this business no matter what happened.
Hammond integrated the session by including an obscure white clarinetist named Benny Goodman.
One of the really important people in my life was Benny Goodman. It's a very unlikely combination, too, because Benny was a pretty tough guy from Chicago. He didn't have that much of a social point of view, and he couldn't understand why I did. But he loved black music. Benny was making his living as a sideman in New York. Of course, those were all white bands, and Benny said if it was known that he played with black guys, he would be barred from further work. New York City was just about as segregated, I'd say, as Birmingham, Alabama. I mean, a black person couldn't even eat a Child's restaurant. You know, I mean, Child's was a chain of cheap restaurants in New York. Schraff's, forget it. And Longchamp. You'd be asked firmly to leave. There were no such things as mixed bands. The first two sessions that I did with Benny was with an all-white group, which just killed me. I was determined never to make any, racially exclusive Records.
It bothered him so terribly, I think it haunted him at night. I imagine he didn't sleep well thinking about it. And he was going to change things even if he lost his job, which he didn't one time. He didn't care. He was going to make that a different world.
Just after I first recorded Benny, I brought in a black piano player from Chicago called Teddy Wilson.
Everybody was going along with the rules of the day. And nobody was, had any idea, or average person didn't have any idea of changing this thing. So the rebel was John Hammond.
If I was going to break the color line, Teddy would be the guy who could keep up with Benny every which way and perhaps even be a little ahead of him. We started the Benny Goodman Trio with Gene Krupa and Teddy Wilson.
Just doing the Teddy Wilson thing, that was a daring thing, both on John's part and on Benny Goodman's part.
In the summer of 1935, Hammond brought Goodman and Wilson together for two recording sessions, including the debut of the Goodman Trio. John knew that wasn't enough to break the color bar. When he arranged for Teddy to play with Benny in public, an historic step was taken in breaking down the bar against integrated bands.
The following summer, I was out in Los Angeles and I heard a vibe player by the name of Lionel Hampton. It was my theory with Benny's band that it was important always to have some new kick in the band. And later with Charlie Christian and Fletcher Henderson and other people, I mean, there was a lot of integration in the Goodman band, and Benny was the guy responsible for it.
When musician Mary Lou Williams told Hammond about a young man in Oklahoma City who played an electrically amplified guitar, he immediately arranged for Charlie Christian to travel to Los Angeles and audition for Goodman.
Charlie Christian came in, and he was a Texas boy. He was maybe 20, and he had all his equipment. I mean, Benny had never seen an amplifier for a guitar before.
Benny called it a sacrilege to amplify a guitar. That night, Hammond arranged to have Christian on the bandstand without Goodman's knowledge.
Benny got on the stand, and he took a look down, and there was Charlie Christian. So he looked at Charlie, and Charlie looked up, and well, first there was one chorus, and then there was two choruses, and finally, after about 16 choruses, the place was in an uproar.
Benny's band became a showcase for John's discoverers. Their relationship was further cemented when Benny married John's sister, Alice.
Now, will you go back and tell us what must be the central episode in the creation of swing when you brought Fletcher Henderson and Benny Goodman together?
Fletcher Henderson, as a leader, he was the one man who made full use of all the improvising soloists that he had in the band. In 1934, when Benny Goodman found himself right in this very studio in the NBC Let's Dance program with a budget that provided for 8 arrangements a week, it was kind of providential that he and Fletcher got together. And I guess it was...
You brought them together.
Maybe, if you want to
say
that. All right. And then it was my role kind of to persuade both Benny and Fletcher that what they should do with the pop tunes of the day is to swing them.
We'll be right back.
January of 1936, when I was out with Benny Goodman, I got so sick of listening to the same tunes every night that one night I went out to my car and I went way to the end of the dial. I started to listen to some music from a band that I had not heard of, from the Reno Club in Kansas City. And I couldn't believe it. It was Count Basie and his orchestra. So I started writing Basie letters at the Reno Club, and I never heard of word.
So finally, one night, I looked up and John was sitting alongside of me. That was really the first time that we really ever got together, and we had a ball.
It was a band I couldn't find any fault with. Lester Young was right in the band. And he had Jimmy Rushing singing the vocals.
Take me back, baby, you're all I'm craving for. Take me back, baby, please let me have once more.
Jimmy Rushing was just marvelous with Basie. He had this kind of volume, and of course he was just as fat then.
Take me back, baby. I'm kind of plump, that's true. Take me back, baby. Here's what I'm gonna do. I'll go on a diet until my shape suits you.
Fletcher Henderson started the liberation of the soloist in the band, and Basie continued it in an extraordinary way, because, you know, a guy like Lester Young could play chorus after chorus after chorus, and Herschel Evans on the other tenor could match him. And the great thing that Basie had were not his arrangements, but the heads, the things that the band collectively got together. Basie sort of weaves in and out.
And now I'd like you to know my favorite vocalist and America's number one song stylist, Miss Billie Holiday.
There wasn't very much work for somebody as revolutionary as Billie, you know. She was not considered a commercial singer.
Hey there, baby, make up your mind, 'cause I've been waiting such a long, long time. Now, baby, or never, I've been so sad and blue.
Hammond had first recorded Holiday back in 1933, the very same week he recorded Bessie Smith's Last Session.
There was a girl singer I liked particularly called Monette Moore, so I came down to this club, and instead of Monette singing, there was this girl, chubby, and I thought quite beautiful. And it turned out she was Billie Holiday. She was 17.
My man, I feel alone. I've got those lost memories.
I'd never heard anybody sing like this, as if she were the most inspired improviser in the world.
I've got those lost memories.
those lost men came back again.
I was convinced then and there that Billy was the best.
Ooh, what a little moonlight can do.
The sessions Hammond produced with Billie Holiday were the zenith of his career as a record producer, endlessly imitated and rarely equaled. Hammond wanted to reach the growing market for jukebox records in black communities. He knew that Billie, a great improviser herself, was inspired by other improvisers. Using Teddy Wilson as his musical director, he assembled small recording groups drawn from the best orchestras of the day, especially Count Basie.
One day, when we did Easy Living, What a Little Moonlight Can Do, I was with Count Basie up in Albany, New York. And we had the worst bus in the world. It was so glassy on the road, the bus spinned around about 8 times. We made it. And we go right in, nobody washed their face or anything. And we make 8 sides. The good days.
I remember me and Prez going down to the studio, but we didn't think we'd be hearing these same records 50 years from that day.
Basie's most admired soloist, Lester Prez Young, emerged as Holiday's ideal recording partner, improvising alongside of her as though he could anticipate her every move.
See, I wish I had at my disposal the language to tell the influence and the impact that John Hammond has on American culture. He revolutionized jazz. He brought it to the forefront by integrating it, making it truly an American art form. It's American classical music. We never think of it in that term, but this is a sophisticated thing.
All of Hammond's musical passions came together in 2 extraordinary evenings at Carnegie Hall. Hammond set out to present the entire spectrum of African-American music to a white urban audience.
Why you can take my man.
Although the concerts, which were dedicated to Bessie Smith, were conceived to trace the roots of jazz from spirituals to swing, the repercussions were felt for decades to come.
The fact that Carnegie Hall, the epitome of high culture, would have a jazz concert was enough to give jazz that kind of legitimacy. And it showed, as I think perhaps nothing had before or since, John's scope.
We had people like Mitchell's Christian Singers, which was about the purest gospel group I ever heard, whom Goddard Lieberson and I brought up from Kinston, North Carolina.
With Mitchell's Christian Singers, he revived interest in gospel. In Joe Turner, he introduced a direct precursor of rock and roll.
I can get Count Basie's band, obviously, and I can bring the boogie-woogie piano players from Chicago and Kansas City, and I can bring quite a few people, but I said there are some southern field hands, you know, that I would love to get up here to New York. We couldn't get Robert Johnson, who had already been murdered by his girlfriend, and so we brought up Big Bill Brunsey from Plantation in Arkansas.
He'd been fishing all my purchase and drying up the bones I'm crying.
Gunner and I had picked up a blind harmonica player called Sonny Terry.
We brought up the Golden Gate Quartet.
Everything seemed to come together. The music of New Orleans, the Mississippi Delta, Kansas City, and more. The whole mosaic of black music, from country blues to the elegant refinements of Count Basie. One result of From Spirituals to Swing was the enormous popularity of Boogie Woogie in the late 1930s. Especially after Hammond suggested that pianist Albert Ammons and Pete Johnson be hired to open a brand new nightclub in Greenwich Village.
Cafe Society was the first thorough breakthrough in terms of integrating nightclubs in this city. Barney Josephson, who deserves the credit, took it as a mission in life to integrate at least nightclubs in the city. If he could have, he would have integrated everything else.
In 1938, I came to New York to start a nightclub. A friend of mine asked me if I knew John Hammond. And John said to me, what kind of club do you plan to open? I said, I'm going to open a nightclub that will be the first interracial nightclub in America. And he said, well, then I can help you.
I got the shows together for Barney Josephson. But I did get paid in a way, because I was able to get dinner free and bring friends and the rest. We got Billy down there with a wonderful band behind her.
Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own. That's got his own.
Now, you saw a part of what was the lettering under Billie Holiday's performance. Was labeled Sugar Child Robinson, as if somebody had misidentified her. And I felt compelled to show you there was a Sugar Child Robinson. And I wanted to give you an idea of what he came to mean. This seven-year-old kid, I think he was about seven when he started making records, movies. Movie shorts in the 40s still. He was at the top of his game at that time, and one of the big stars of the vaudeville and movie short business. And I found a clip of him and Count Basie together in a show done sometime in the mid 40s. It was from Detroit. And I wanted to play this for you. To John Hammond would have been spinning in his grave if he had known that somebody had left the impression that Billie Holiday was Sugar Child Robinson. So I take this opportunity to correct that notion, but also to give you a little taste of who Sugar Child was. and watch him play the piano. He never looks away from the camera. And he was a sensation, and you'll get some idea of what show business like was.
Sugar, it's a pleasure working with you. Tell me, how's things been going with you?
Well, it's a pleasure working with you, too, and things have been going pretty good with me. How about you?
Oh, pretty good, too. Tell me how you're doing with your schooling.
Well, all right, but see, I have a private tutor that travels with me.
Oh, that's wonderful. Do you mind if I ask you a couple of questions?
Oh, no, go right ahead.
How much are 6 and 4?
12.
I'll try again.
11?
How about trying 10?
No, 5 and 5 is 10.
Look, if someone should give your daddy $1 a week for 3 straight weeks, what would he have?
A hat, a new suit, and a television set.
How many letters are there in the alphabet?
I don't know.
You with the private tutor don't know how many there are in the alphabet? I'm surprised.
You've been to the post office.
Many a time.
Well, how many letters are there in the post office?
How many bones in your body?
208.
208? No, I thought it was 207.
I had fish for dinner.
Oh.
Now, back to the subject of Milt Hinton. I want to give you some idea of Cab Calloway. This guy was, I underestimated him for far too long. But he was not a musician. He had no musical training. He was an athlete, a basketball player. In Chicago, where his sister, Blanche, had a band, a good band. And Cab was around, and there was a band, and this happened not infrequently. A band would lose its leader, and somebody would have to take over. Preferably somebody that had a reputation and a name. Cab had neither. But he was persuaded he tried to play the saxophone, and he took over this band, and the guy says, no, that won't do it. You've got to put that thing away. That's not for you. You can't catch up to the rest of these guys who are already in the band. A band called the Missourians. They said, you don't look like anybody else. Your look is unique. You can flip your hair, you can do all of this, and you can do all of this moving around that's unique. You know? And I want to show you a little bit of film that I discovered, God bless YouTube, discovered just sometime this year, earlier this year. And it's this guy had figured out a way to do nonverbal communication, unlike anything I'd ever seen before. And it's a version of I can't give you anything but love. And you'll see him doing all of his acrobatic, athletic dancing. But at the end, he takes Jonah Jones's trumpet solo and make you believe that he's producing those sounds. Look at this. I've never seen anything like that. Has any of you ever saw anything like that? Now, with all of his own athleticism, Cab had a knack for using it to introduce even more virtuosic athleticism. And he does it by, in this tune, this piece called, in the film called, the piece is called Jump and Jive. But it's in the 1943 full-length movie called Stormy Weather. And watch what the Nicholas brothers, these two brothers, tap dancers of great, great renown. Fred Astaire called this performance the greatest piece of film on, greatest piece of dance on film he'd ever seen. Check it out. There's Milt's in the band.
Jumping jive makes you dig your jive on the mellow side. Hip hip, hip hip. The jim jam jump is a solid jive, makes you 9 foot tall when you're 4 foot five. Hip hip, hip hip. Now don't you be that ickaroo, get hip, come on, and then you follow through. You get your study full, you make up the jolly jump of the like of the gators do. Jim jam jump is a jumping jive, makes you like your eggs on the Jersey side. Hip hip, hip hip. The jim jam jumping jive makes you a hip hip on the Mahala side. Diddly 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 bumpity diddly diddly bang 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 di da da. Now I've told you about the jumping jive. Jim jam jump the jumping jive. You got to dig this mellow jive, yes yes. You dig it on the Mahala side. Diddly 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 boy. Diddly diddly boy.
Thank you.
I'm going to close with a clip, again, that I just discovered on YouTube. YouTube is really changing my world in big ways. And this, you know, I had never seen any performance or heard of any performance of Duke Ellington and his orchestra where the band sings. They were great instrumentalists, and Duke was the architect of arranging and of making, inventing new sounds for these instruments to do. But this YouTube piece, it was clearly a short, probably intended to invigorate the sales of the new piece, Take the A-Train, when Strayhorn first joined the organization there. And I turned this thing on here, and there is the band singing, and Ray Nance dancing, and the girl singing is a singer that I played bass for at the Monterey on Dixwell Avenue when my first year at Yale. I'm 18 and playing, and I'm looking at this on YouTube at this lady who used to come up on weekends and work at Mr. Greenlee's joint. This is something quite special, I think, this version of Take the A-Train, and with it, I rest my case. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, sir. Thank you, thank you. Thanks. That's fun.
Thank you, everybody. There's a reception now in the mayor lobby for those of you who want to have some drinks and talk to Willie. And again, I just want to thank him for his incredible contributions to Yale, our larger community of New Haven and the world, for what he's done throughout his long, long career in music. I want you to know that Mitch Lee, his dear friend who named Lee Hall, one of the things he did before he passed away was to endow the jazz professorship at Yale in honor of his great friend and classmate, Willie Ruff.
All right, man. Thank you.